Well, hey folks, it's been a while since I've done this. I figured I'd get some free time this week, and possibly for a couple more weeks, we'll see. I figured I'd start out slow by doing the whole, like, the last time I did this, I basically, like, sweet, I got an interview on Thursday. 10:30 a.m. Fucking awesome. So yeah, Anyways, I was gonna play some Deathstate and listen to some Philip K. Dick. If you don't know, Philip K. Dick's probably my favorite author. Out of all the crap I've read over the last couple 15, 20 years, whatever. Either way, we're gonna listen to some short stories by him from a collection. I think it's the last collection. It's it's named a couple of different things. One's Little Black Box. I'm pretty sure this is also known as We Can Remember It For You, Wholesale. It's the fifth book in his short story collected works, basically. The one that was published last. But we're gonna start out with Little Black Box. Actually, I'll probably start out with the introduction, because I like the introduction, and it's by Thomas M. Dish, another awesome science fiction author, if you haven't heard of him. Gonna do the introduction, and then go right into Little Black Box. And then I'll probably skip around. I'll probably do... We Can Remember For You, Wholesale, which is Total Recall. And or The Electric Ant. I like We Can Remember For You, Wholesale better, so I'll do that one, and then if I still feel up to streaming, we'll listen to The Electric Ant. So let's get to it.
Introduction by Thomas M. Dish. The conventional wisdom has it that there are writers' writers and readers' writers. The latter are those happy few whose books, by some pheromonic chemistry, the former can never quite duplicate in their own laboratories, appear year after year on the bestseller lists. They may, or more usually, may not satisfy the upmarket tastes of lit books sell. Writers' writers get great reviews, especially from their admiring readers, who can recognize a review the signs of a book by a writer's writer. The prose style comes in for high praise. A true reader's writer, by contrast, would not want to be accused of anything so elitist as style. The characters have depth. Above all, such a book is serious. Many writer's writers aspire to the wider fame and higher advances of reader's writers, and occasionally a reader's writer will covet such laurels as royalties cannot buy. Henry James, the writer's writer par excellence, wrote one of his drollest tales, The Next Time, about just such a pair of cross-purposed writers. And James's conclusion is entirely true to life. The literary writer does his best to write a blockbuster, and it wins him more laurels, but no more readers. The successful hack does her damnedest to produce a work of art. The critics sneer, but it is her greatest commercial success. Philip K. Dick was, in his time, both a writer's writer and a reader's writer, and neither, and another kind altogether, a science fiction writer's science fiction writer. The proof of the last contention is to be found blazoned on the covers of a multitude of his paperback books, where his colleagues have vied to lavish superlatives on him. John Brunner called him the most consistently brilliant science fiction writer in the world. Norman Spinrad trumps this, but the greatest American novelist of the second half of the 20th century. Ursula Le Guin anoints him as America's Borges, which Harlan Ellison tops by hailing him as SF's Pirandello, its Beckett, and its Pinter. Brian Aldiss, Michael Bishop, myself, and many others have all written Encomia as extravagant, but all these praises had very little effect on the sales of the books they garlanded during the years those books were being written. Dick managed to survive as a full-time freelance writer only by virtue of his immense productivity. Witness the sheer expanse of these collected stories, and consider that most of his readers didn't consider Dick a short story writer at all, but but knew him chiefly by his novels. It is significant, I think, that all the praise heaped on Dick was exclusively from other SF writers, not from the reputation makers of the literary establishment, for he was not like writers outside genre fiction. It's not for his exquisite style he's applauded, or his depth of characterization. Dick's prose seldom soars, and often is lame, as any Quasimodo.
Yeah, it is.
The characters in even some of his most memorable tales have all the depth of a 50s sitcom. A more kindly way to think of it, he writes for the traditional complement of America's indigenous commedia dell'arte. Even stories that one remembers as exceptions to this rule can prove, on rereading, to have more in common with Bradbury and Van Vogt than with Borges and Pinter. Dick is content, most of the time, with a narrative surface as simple, even simple-minded, as a comic book. One need go no further than the first story in this book, The Little Black Box, for proof of this. It was done in 1963, when Dick was at the height of his powers, writing such classic novels as The Man in the High Castle and Martian Timeslip. Further, Box contains the embryo for another of his best novels of later years, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? Why, then, such peons? For any aficionado of SF, the answer is self-evident. He had great ideas. Fans of genre writing have usually been able to tolerate sloppiness of execution for the sake of genuine novelty, since the bane of genre fiction has been the constant recycling of old plots and premises. And Dick's great ideas occupied a unique waveband on the imaginative spectrum. Not for him the conquest of space. In Dick, the colonization of the solar system simply results in new and more dismal suburbs being built. Not for him the Halloween mummeries of inventing new breeds of alien monsters. Dick was always too conscious of the human face behind the Halloween mask to bother with elaborate masquerades. Dick's great ideas sprang up from the world around him, from the neighborhoods he lived in, the newspapers he read, the stores he shopped in, the ads on TV. His novels and stories taken all together comprise one of the most accurate and comprehensive pictures of American culture in the Populux and Vietnam eras that exist in contemporary fiction, not because of his accuracy in the matter of inventorying the trivia of those times, but because he discovered metaphors that uncovered the meaning of the way we lived. He made of our commonplaces worlds of wonder. What more can we ask of art? Well, the answer is obvious. Polish, execution, economy of means, and other aesthetic niceties. Most SF writers, however, have been able to get along without table linen and crystals so long as the protein of a meaty metaphor was there on the plate. Indeed, Dick's aesthetic failings could become virtues for his fellow SF writers, since it's so often possible for us to take the ball he fumbled and continue for a touchdown. Ursula Le Guin's The Lathe of Heaven is one of the best novels Dick ever wrote, except that he didn't. My own 334 would surely have not been the same book without the example of his own accounts of future drabness. The list of his conscious debtors is long, and of his unconscious debtors, undoubtedly even longer. Phil's own note at the back of this book to his story, The Prepersons, provides an illuminating example of the kind of reaction he could have on a fellow writer. In this case, Joanna Russ allegedly offered to beat him up for his tale of a young boy's apprehension by the driver of a local abortion truck, who operates like a dog catcher in rounding up prepersons, children under 12 no longer wanted by their parents, and taking them into abortion centers to be gassed. It's an inspired piece of propaganda. Phil calls it special pleading, to which the only adequate response is surely not a threat to beat up the author, but a story that dramatizes the same issue as forcefully, and that does not shirk the interesting but troublemaking question, if abortion, why not infanticide? Dick's raising of this question in the current polarized climate of debate was a coup de théâtre, but scarcely the last word on the subject. One could easily extrapolate an entire novel from the essential premise of The Prepersons, and it wouldn't necessarily be an anti-abortion tract. Dick's stories often flowered into novels when he reconsidered his first good idea, and the reason he is a science fiction writer, is because his stories so often have had the same effect on his colleagues. Reading a story by Dick isn't like contemplating a finished work of art. Much more, it's like becoming involved in a conversation. I'm glad to be a part, here, of that continuing conversation. Thomas M. Dish, October 1986. The Little Black Box. Bogart Crofts of the State Department said, "Miss Ayashi, we want to send you to Cuba to give religious instruction to the Chinese population there. It's your Oriental background. It'll help." With a faint moan, Joan Hiyashi reflected that her Oriental background consisted of having been born in Los Angeles and having attended courses at UCSB, the University of Santa Barbara. But she was technically, from the standpoint of training, an Asian scholar, and she had properly listed this on her job application form. "Let's consider the word caritas," Crofts was saying. "In your estimation, what actually does it mean, as Jerome used it? Charity? Hardly. But then what? Friendliness? Love?" Joan said, "My field is Zen Buddhism." "But everybody," Crofts protested in dismay, "knows what caritas means in late Roman usage. The esteem of good people for one another. That's what it means." His gray, dignified eyebrows raised. "Do you want this job, Miss Hiyashi? And if so, why?" "I want to disseminate Zen Buddhist propaganda to the communist Chinese in Cuba," Joan said, "because..." She hesitated. The truth was simply that it meant a good salary for her, the first truly high-paying job she had ever held. From a career standpoint, it was a plum. "Oh, hell," she said. "What is the nature of the one way? I don't have any answer." "It's evident that your field has taught you a method of avoiding giving honest answers," Crofts said sourly, "and being evasive. However," he shrugged, "possibly that only goes to prove that you're well-trained and the proper person for the job. In Cuba, you'll be running up against some rather worldly and sophisticated individuals who, in addition, are quite well-off, even from the U.S. standpoint. I hope you can cope with them as well as you've coped with me." Joan said, "Thank you, Mr. Crofts." She rose. "I'll expect to hear from you then." "I am impressed by you," Crofts said, half to himself. "After all, you're the young lady who first had the idea of feeding Zen Buddhist riddles to UCSB's big computers." "I was the first to do it," Joan corrected. "But the idea came from a friend of mine, Ray Meriton, the gray-green jazz harpist." "Jazz and Zen Buddhism," Crofts said. "State may be able to make use of you in Cuba." To Ray Meriton, she said, "I have to get out of Los Angeles, Ray. I really can't stand the way we're living here." She walked to the window of his apartment and looked out at the monorail gleaming far off. The silver car made its way at enormous speed, and Joan hurriedly looked away. "If only we could suffer," she thought. "That's what we lack, any real experience of suffering, because we can escape anything, even this." "But you are getting out," Ray said. "You're going to Cuba and convert wealthy merchants and bankers into becoming ascetics. It's a genuine Zen paradox. You'll be paid for it," he chuckled. "Fed into a computer, a thought like that would do harm. Anyhow, you won't have to sit in the Crystal Hall every night listening to me play, if that's what you're anxious to get away from." "No," Joan said. "I expect to keep on listening to you on TV. I may even be able to use your music in my teachings." From a rosewood chest in the far corner of the room, she lifted out a .32 pistol. It belonged to Ray Meriton's second wife, Edna, who had used it to kill herself the previous February, late one rainy afternoon. "May I take this along?" she asked. "For sentiment," Ray said, "because she did it on your account." "Edna did nothing on my account. Edna liked me. I'm not taking any responsibility for your wife's suicide, even though she did find out about us, seeing each other, so to speak." Ray said meditatively, "And you're the girl always telling people to accept blame and not to project it out on the world. What do you call your principal deer? He grinned. The anti-paranoia princip. Dr. Joan Hiyashi's cure for mental illness. Absorb all blame, take it all upon yourself. He glanced up at her and said acutely, I'm surprised you're not a follower of Wilbur Mercer. That clown? Joan said. But that's part of his appeal. Here, I'll show you. Ray switched on the TV set across the room from them, the legless black oriental style set with its ornamentation of Sung Dynasty dragons. Odd, you would know when Mercer is on, Joan said. Ray, shrugging, murmured, I'm interested. A new religion replacing Zen Buddhism, sweeping out of the Middle West to engulf California. You ought to pay attention, too, since you claim religion as your profession. You're getting a job because of it. Religion is paying your bills, my dear, so don't knock it. The TV had come on, and there was Wilbur Mercer. Why isn't he saying anything? Joan said. Why, Mercer has taken a vow this week. Complete silence. Ray lit a cigarette. State ought to be sending me, not you. You're a fake. At least I'm not a clown, Joan said, or a follower of a clown. Ray reminded her softly, there's a Zen saying, the Buddha is a piece of toilet paper. And another, the Buddha often... Be still, she said sharply. I want to watch Mercer. You want to watch? Ray's voice was heavy with irony. Is that what you want, for God's sake? No one watches Mercer. That's the whole point. Tossing his cigarette into the fireplace, he strode to the TV set. There, before it, Joan saw a metal box with two handles attached by a lead of twin cable wire to the TV set. Ray seized the two handles, and at once a grimace of pain shot across his face. What is it? She asked in anxiety. Nothing. Ray continued to grip the handles. On the screen, Wilbur Mercer walked slowly over the barren, jagged surface of a desolate hillside. His face lifted, an expression of serenity, or vacuity, on his thin, middle-aged features. Gasping, Ray released the handles. I could only hold them for 45 seconds this time. To Joan, he explained, This is the empathy box, my dear. I can't tell you how I got it. To be truthful, I don't really know. They brought it by, the organization that distributes it, Wilser Incorporated. But I can tell you that when you take hold of these handles, you're no longer watching Wilbur Mercer. You're actually participating in his apotheosis. Why, you're feeling what he feels. Joan said, It looks like it hurts. Quietly, Ray Meriden said, Yes, but Wilbur Mercer is being killed. He's walking to the place where he's going to die. In horror, Joan moved away from the box. You said that's what we needed, Ray said. Remember, I'm a rather adequate telepath. I don't have to bestir myself very much to read your thoughts. If only we could suffer. That's what you were thinking just a little while ago. Well, here's your chance, Joan.
It's morbid.
Was your thought morbid?
Yes, she said.
Ray Meriden said, 20 million people are followers of Wilbur Mercer now. All over the world. And they're suffering with him as he walks along toward Pueblo, Colorado. At least that's where they're told he's going. Personally, I have my doubts. Anyhow, Mercerism is now what Zen Buddhism was once. You're going to Cuba to teach the wealthy Chinese bankers a form of asceticism that's already obsolete, already seen its day. Silently, Joan turned away from him and watched Mercer walking. You know I'm right, Ray said. I can pick up your emotions. You may not be aware of them, but they're there. On the screen, a rock was thrown at Mercer. It struck him on the shoulder. Everyone who's holding on to his empathy box, Joan realized, felt that along with Mercer. Ray nodded. You're right.
And what about when he's actually killed?
She shuddered. We'll see what happens then, Ray said quietly. We don't know. To Bogart Crofts, Secretary of State Douglas Herrick said.
I think you're wrong, Bogue. The girl may be Merrin's mistress, but that doesn't mean she knows.
We'll wait for Mr. Lee to tell us, Croft said irritably. When she gets to Havana, he'll be waiting to meet her.
Mr. Lee can't scan Merritt direct?
One telepath scan another?
Bogart Croft smiled at the thought.
It conjured up a nonsensical situation. Mr. Lee reading Merritt's mind, and Merritt, also being a telepath, would read Mr. Lee's mind, and discover that Mr. Lee was reading his mind, and Lee reading Merritt's mind would discover that Merritt knew, and so forth. Endless regression, winding up with a fusion of minds, within which Merritt carefully guarded his thoughts so that he did not think about Wilbur Mercer.
It's the similarity of names that convinces me, Herrick said. Merritt, Mercer, the first three letters?
Croft said, Ray Merritt is not Wilbur Mercer. I'll tell you how we know. Over at CIA, we made an Ampex videotape from Mercer's telecast, had it enlarged and analyzed. Mercer was shown against the usual dismal background of cactus plants and sand and rock, you know.
Yes, Herrick said, nodding. The wilderness, as they call it.
In the enlargement, something showed up in the sky. It was studied. It's not Luna. It's a moon, but too small to be Luna. Mercer is not on Earth. I would guess that he is not a terrestrial at all. Bending down, Crofts picked up a small metal box, carefully avoiding the two handles. And these were not designed and built on Earth. The entire Mercer movement is null-T all the way, and that's the fact we've got to contend with. Herrick said,
If Mercer is not a Terran, then he may have suffered and even died before on other planets.
Oh, yes, Crofts said. Mercer, or whatever his real name is, may be highly experienced in this. But we still don't know what we want to know. And that, of course, was what happens to those people holding on to the handles of their empathy boxes. Croft seated himself at his desk and scrutinized the box resting directly before him with its two inviting handles. He had never touched them, and he never intended to, but...
How soon will Mercer die?
Herrick asked. They're expecting it sometime late next week.
And Mr. Lee will have gotten something from the girl's mind by then, you think? Some clue as to where Mercer really is?
I hope so, Croft said, still seated at the empathy box, but still not touching it. It must be a strange experience, he thought, to place your hands on two ordinary-looking metal handles and find all at once that you're no longer yourself. You're another man entirely, in another place, laboring up a long, dreary inclined plane towards certain extinction. At least so they say. But hearing about it, what does that actually convey? Suppose I tried it for myself. The sense of absolute pain, that was what appalled him, held him back. It was unbelievable that people could deliberately seek it out, rather than avoiding it. Gripping the handles of the empathy box was certainly not the act of a person seeking escape. It was not the avoidance of something, but the seeking of something. And not the pain as such. Crofts knew better than to suppose that the Mercerites were simple masochists who desired comfort. It was, he knew, the meaning of the pain which attracted Mercer's followers. The followers were suffering from something. Aloud, he said to his superior, They want to suffer as a means of denying their private personal existences. It's a communion in which they all suffer and experience Mercer's ordeal together. Like the Last Supper, he thought. That's the real key, the communion, the participation that is behind all religion, or ought to be. Religion binds men together in a sharing corporate body and leaves everyone else on the outside. Herrick said,
But primarily it's a political movement or must be treated as such.
From our standpoint, Crofts agreed. Not theirs. The intercom on the desk buzzed, and his secretary said, Sir, Mr. John Lee is here. Tell him to come in. The tall, slender young Chinese entered, smiling, his hand out. He wore an old-fashioned single-breasted suit and pointed black shoes.
As they shook hands, Mr. Lee said, "She has not left for Havana, has she?"
"No," Croft said.
"Is she pretty?"
Mr. Lee said.
"Yes," Croft said, with a smile at Herrick. "But difficult. A snappish kind of woman. Emancipated, if you follow me."
"Oh, the suffragette type," Mr. Lee said, smiling.
"I detest that type of female. It will be hard going, Mr. Crofts."
"Remember," Crofts said, "your job is simply to be converted. All you have to do is listen to her propaganda about Zen Buddhism. Learn to ask a few questions, such as, 'Is this stick the Buddha?' And expect a few inexplicable blows on the head. A Zen practice, I understand. Supposed to instill sense." With a broad grin, Mr. Lee said, "Or to instill nonsense. You see, I am prepared. Sense, nonsense. In Zen, it's the same thing." He became sober now. "Of course, I am a communist," he said. "The only reason I'm doing this is because the party in Havana has taken the official stand that Mercerism is dangerous and must be wiped out." He looked gloomy. "I must say, these Mercerites are fanatics."
"True," Crofts agreed. "And we must work for their extinction." He pointed to the empathy box. "Have you ever..."
"Yes," Mr. Lee said. "It's a form of punishment. Self-imposed, no doubt, for reasons of guilt. Leisure gleans such emotions from people. If it is properly utilized. Otherwise, not." Crofts thought, "This man has no understanding of the issues at all. He's a simple materialist. Typical of a person born in a communist family, raised in a communist society. Everything is either black or white."
"You're mistaken," Mr. Lee said. He had picked up Croft's thought.
Flushing, Croft said, "Sorry, I forgot. No offense."
"I see in your mind," Mr. Lee said, "that you believe Wilbur Mercer, as he calls himself, may be non-T. Do you know the party's position on this question? It was debated just a few days ago. The party takes the stand that there are no non-T races in the solar system, that to believe remnants of once superior races still exist is a form of morbid mysticism."
Croft sighed. "Shit. Deciding an empirical issue by vote. Deciding it on a strictly political basis. I can't understand that." At that point, Secretary Herrick spoke up, soothing both men.
"Please, let's not become sidetracked by theoretical issues on which we don't all agree. Let's stick to basics. The Mercerite Party and its rapid growth all over the planet."
Mr. Lee said, "You are right, of course."
Fuck.
At the Havana airfield, Joan Hiyashi looked around her as the other passengers walked rapidly from a ship to the entrance of the number 20 concourse. Relatives and friends had surged cautiously out onto the field, as they always did, in defiance of field rulings. She saw among them a tall, lean, young Chinese man with a smile of greeting on his face.
Raining mummies.
Walking
fuck
toward
you.
Him, she called, "Mr. Lee?" "Yes." He hurried toward her. "It's dinner time. Would you care to eat? I'll take you to the Hang Fa Lo restaurant. They have pressed duck and bird's nest soup, all Canton style. Very sweet, but good once in a long while." Soon they were at the restaurant, in a red leather and imitation teak booth. Cubans and Chinese chattered on all sides of them. The air smelled of frying pork and cigar smoke.
"You are president of the Havana Institute for Asian Studies," she asked,
just to be certain there had been no slip-ups.
"Correct. It is frowned on by the Cuban Communist Party because of the religious aspect, but many of the Chinese here on the island attend lectures or are on our mailing list. As you know, we've had many distinguished scholars from Europe and Southern Asia come and address us. By the way, there is a Zen parable which I do not understand. The monk who cut the kitten in half. I have studied it and thought about it. But I do not see how the Buddha could be present when cruelty was done to an animal." He hastened to add, "But I'm not disputing with you. I am merely seeking information."
Joan said,
Of all the Zen parables, that has caused the most difficulty. The question to ask is, where is the kitten now?
That recalls the opening of the Bhagavad Gita, Mr. Lee said with a quick nod. I recall Arjuna saying, the bow Gandiva slips from my hand. Omens of evil. What can we hope from this killing of kinsmen?
Correct, Jones said. And of course you remember Krishna's answer. It is the most profound statement in all pre-Buddhistic religion of the issue of death and of action.
The waiter came for their order. He was a Cuban in khaki and a beret.
Try the fried wonton, Mr. Lee advised. And the chow yuk.
And of course the egg roll.
You have egg roll today?
He asked the waiter.
Si, Señor Lee.
The waiter picked at his teeth with a toothpick. Mr. Lee ordered for both of them, and the waiter departed.
You know, Jones said, when you've been around a telepath as much as I have, you become conscious of intensive scanning going on. I could always tell when Ray was trying to dig at something in me. You're a telepath. You're very intensively scanning me right now.
Smiling, Mr. Lee said, I wish I was, Miss Hiyashi.
I have nothing to hide, Jones said. But I wonder why you are so interested in what I'm thinking. You know I'm an employee of the United States Department of State. There's nothing secret about that. Are you afraid I've come to Cuba as a spy? To study military installations? Is it something like that?
She felt depressed.
This is not a good beginning, she said. You haven't been honest with me.
You are a very attractive woman, Miss Hiyashi, Mr. Lee said, losing none of his poise.
I was merely curious to see, shall I be blunt, your attitude toward sex. You're lying,
Jones said quietly. Now the bland smile departed. He stared at her.
Burstness soup, senor.
The waiter had returned. He set the hot steaming bowl in the center of the table.
Tea.
He laid out a teapot and two small white handleless cups.
Senorita, you want chopsticks?
No,
she said absently. From outside the booth came a cry of anguish. Both Joan and Mr. Lee leaped up. Mr. Lee pulled the curtain aside. The waiter was staring too, and laughing. At a table in the opposite corner of the restaurant sat an elderly Cuban gentleman with his hands gripping the handles of an empathy box.
Here too, Jones said.
They are pests, Mr. Lee said, disturbing our meal. The waiter said, Loco. He shook his head, still chuckling.
Yes, Jones said. Mr. Lee, I will continue here, trying to do my job, despite what's occurred between us. I don't know why they deliberately sent a telepath to meet me. Possibly it's communist paranoid suspicions of outsiders. But in any case, I have a job to do here, and I mean to do it. So shall we discuss the dismembered kitten?
At mealtime? Mr. Lee said faintly.
You brought it up, Jones said, and proceeded despite the expression of acute misery on Mr. Lee's face as he sat spooning up his bird's nest soup.
At the Los Angeles studio of television station KKHF, Ray Meriton sat at his harp, waiting for his cue. How high the moon, he had decided, would be his first number. He yawned, kept his eye on the control board. Beside him at the blackboard, jazz commentator Glenn Goldstream polished his rimless glasses with a fine linen handkerchief and said, I think I'll tie in with Gustav Mahler tonight. Who the hell is he? A great late 19th century composer, very romantic. Wrote long, peculiar symphonies and folk-type songs. I'm thinking, however, of the rhythmic patterns in the drunkard in springtime from Song of the Earth. You've never heard it?
Nope,
Meriton said restlessly. Very gray-green. Ray Meriton did not feel very gray-green tonight. His head still ached from the rock thrown at Wilbur Mercer. Meriton had tried to let go of the empathy box when he saw the rock coming, but he had not been quick enough. It had struck Mercer on the right temple, drawing blood.
I've run into 3 Mercerites this evening, Glenn said, and all of them look terrible. What happened to Mercer today? How would I know? You're carrying yourself the way they did today. It's your head, isn't it? I know you well enough, Ray. You'd be mixed up in anything new and odd. What do I care if you're a Mercerite? I just thought maybe you'd like a pain pill. Brusquely, Ray Meriton said, that would defeat the entire idea, wouldn't it? A pain pill. Here, Mr. Mercer, as you go up the hillside, how about a shot of morphine? You won't feel a thing. He rippled a few cadences on his harp, releasing his emotions. You're on, the producer said from the control room. Their theme, That's a Plenty, swelled from the tape deck in the control room, and the number 2 camera facing Goldstream lit up its red light. Arms folded, Goldstream said, Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. What is jazz? That's what I say, Meriton thought. What is jazz? What is life? He rubbed his splintered, pain-racked forehead and wondered how he could endure the next week. Wilbur Mercer was getting close to it now. Each day it would become worse. And after a brief pause for an important message, Goldstream was saying, We'll be back to tell you more about the world of gray-green men and women, those peculiar people, and the world of the artistry of the one and only Ray Meriton. The tape of the commercial appeared on the TV monitor facing Meriton. Meriton said to Goldstream, I'll take the pain pill. A yellow, flat-notched tablet was held out to him. Paracodeine, Goldstream said. Highly illegal, but effective. An addictive drug. I'm surprised you, of all people, don't carry some. I used to, Ray said. I got a decent cup of water and swallowed the pill.
Nope.
Water and swallowed the pill. And now you're on Mercerism. Now I'm. He glanced at Goldstream. They had known each other in their professional capacities for years. I'm not a Mercerite, he said. So forget it, Glenn. It's just coincidence I got a headache the night Mercer was hit on the temple by a sharp rock thrown by some moronic sadist who ought to be the one dragging his way up that hillside. He scowled at Goldstream. I understand, Goldstream said, that the U.S. Department of Mental Health is on the verge of asking the Justice Department to pick up the Mercerites. Suddenly he swung to face camera 2. A faint smile touched his face and he said smoothly, Gray-Green began about 4 years ago in Pinole, California, at the now justly famous Double Shot Club, where Ray Meriton played back in 1993 and 4. Tonight, Ray will let us hear one of his best-known and liked numbers, Once in Love with Amy. He swung in Meriton's direction. Ray Meriton! Plunk, plunk, the harp went as Ray Meriton's fingers riffled the strings. An object lesson, he thought as he played. That's what the FBI would make me into for the teenagers, to show them what not to grow up to be. First on paracodeine, now on Mercer. Beware, kids. Off camera, Glenn Goldstream held up a sign he had scribbled. Is Mercer a non-terrestrial? Underneath this, Goldstream wrote in a marking pencil, It's that they want to know. Invasion from outside there somewhere, Meriton thought to himself as he played. That's what they're afraid of, fear of the unknown, like tiny children. That's our ruling circles, tiny, fear-ridden children playing ritualistic games with super powerful toys. A thought came to him from one of the network officials in the control room. Mercer has been injured. At once, Ray Meriton turned his attention that way, scanned as hard as he could. His fingers strummed the harp reflexively. Government outlawing so-called empathy boxes. He thought immediately of his own empathy box before his TV set in the living room of his apartment. Organization which distributes and sells the empathy boxes declared illegal. An FBI making arrests in several major cities. Other countries expected to follow. How badly injured, he wondered. Dying. And what about the Mercerites who have been holding on to the handles of their empathy boxes at that moment? How were they now? Receiving medical attention? Should we air the news now? The network official was thinking. Or wait until the commercial? Ray Meriton ceased playing his harp and said clearly into the boom microphone, Wilbur Mercer has been injured. This is what we've expected, but it's still a major tragedy. Mercer is a saint. Wide-eyed, Glenn Goldstream gawked at him. I believe in Mercer, Ray Meriton said, and all across the United States, his television audience heard his confession of faith. I believe his suffering and injury and death have meaning for each of us. It was done. He had gone on record and hadn't even taken much courage. Pray for Wilbur Mercer, he said, and resumed playing his gray-green style of harp. You fool, Glenn Goldstream was thinking, giving yourself away. You'll be in jail within a week. Your career is ruined. Plunk, plunk, Ray played on his harp and smiled humorlessly at Glenn. Mr. Lee said, do you know the story of the Zen monk who was playing hide-and-go-seek with the children? Was it Basho who tells this? The monk hid in an outhouse, and the children did not think of looking there, and so they forgot him. He was a very simple man. Next day, I admit that Zen is a form of stupidity, Joan Hiyashi said. It extols the virtues of being simple and gullible. And remember, the original meaning of gullible is one who is easily gulled, easily cheated. She sipped a little of her tea and found it now cold. Then you are a true practitioner of Zen, Mr. Lee said, because you have been gulled. He reached inside his coat and brought out a pistol, which he pointed at Joan. You're under arrest. By the Cuban government? She managed to say. By the United States government, Mr. Lee said. I have read your mind, and I learn that you know that Ray Meriton is a prominent Mercerite, and you yourself are attracted to Mercerism. But I'm not. Unconsciously, you are attracted. You are about to switch over. I can pick up those thoughts, even if you deny them to yourself. We are going back to the United States, you and I, and there we will find Mr. Ray Meriton, and he will lead us to Wilbur Mercer. It is as simple as that. And this is why I was sent to Cuba? I am a member of the Central Committee of the Cuban Communist Party, Mr. Lee said, and the sole telepath on that committee. We have voted to work in cooperation with the United States Department of State during this current Mercer crisis. Our plane, Miss Hiyashi, leaves for Washington, D.C. in half an hour. Let us get down to the airport at once. Joan Hiyashi looked helplessly about the restaurant. Other people eating, the waiters. Nobody paid attention. She rose to her feet as a waiter passed with a heavily loaded tray. This man, she said, pointing to Mr. Lee, is kidnapping me. Help me, please. The waiter glanced at Mr. Lee, saw who it was, smiled at Joan and shrugged. Mr. Lee, he is an important man, the waiter said, and went on with his tray. What he says is true, Mr. Lee said to her. Joan ran from the booth and across the restaurant. Help me, she said to the elderly Cuban Mercerite who sat with his empathy box before him. I'm a Mercerite. They're arresting me. The lined old face lifted. The man scrutinized her. Help me, she said. Praise Mercer, the old man said. You can't help me, she realized. She turned back to Mr. Lee, who had followed after her, still holding the pistol pointed at her. This old man is not going to do a thing, Mr. Lee said. Not even get to his feet. She sagged. All right, I know. The television set in the corner suddenly ceased its yammering of daytime trash. The image of a woman's face and bottle of cleanser abruptly disappeared, and there was only blackness. Then, in Spanish, a news announcer began to speak. Hurt, Mr. Lee said, listening. But Mercer is not dead. How do you feel, Miss Hiyashi, as a Mercerite? Does this affect you? Oh, but
That's right. One must take hold of the handles first for it to reach you. It must be a voluntary act. Joan picked up the elderly Cuban's empathy box, held it for a moment, and then seized the handles. Mr. Lee stared at her in surprise. He moved toward her, reaching for the box. It was not pain that she felt. Is this how it is? She wondered as she saw around her the restaurant dim and faded. Maybe Wilbur Mercer is unconscious. That must be it. I'm escaping from you, she thought to Mr. Lee. You can't. Or at least you won't follow me where I've gone. Into the tomb world of Wilbur Mercer, who is dying somewhere on a barren plain, surrounded by his enemies. Now I'm with him. And it is an escape from something worse, from you. And you're never going to be able to get me back. She saw around her a desolate expanse. The air smelled of harsh blossoms. This was the desert, and there was no rain. A man stood before her, a sorrowful light in his gray, pain-drenched eyes. I am your friend, he said, but you must go on as if I did not exist. Can you understand that? He spread his empty hands. No, she said, I can't understand that. How can I save you, the man said, if I can't save myself? He smiled. Don't you see? There is no salvation. Then what's it all for? She asked. To show you, Wilbur Mercer said, that you aren't alone. I am here with you and always will be. Go back and face them and tell them that. She released the handles. Mr. Lee, holding his gun to her, said, Well? Let's go, she said. Back to the United States. Turn me over to the FBI. It doesn't matter. What did you see? Mr. Lee said with curiosity. I won't tell you. But I can learn it anyhow, from your mind. He was probing now, listening with his head cocked on one side. The corners of his mouth turned down as if he was pouting. I don't call that much, he said. Mercer looks you in the face and says he can't do anything for you. Is this the man you'd lay down your life for, you and the others? You're ill. In the society of the insane, Joan said, the sick are well. What nonsense, Mr. Lee said. Bogart Crofts, Mr. Lee said. It was interesting. She became a Mercerite directly in front of me. The latency transforming itself into actuality. It proved I was correct in what I previously read in her mind. We'll have Merritt picked up any time now, Crofts said to his superior, Secretary Herrick. He left the television studio in Los Angeles, where he got news of Mercer's severe injury. After that, no one seems to know what he did. He did not return to his apartment. The local police picked up his empathy box. And he was beyond a doubt not on the premises. Where is Joan Hiyashi? Crofts asked. Being held now in New York, Mr. Lee said. On what charge? Crofts asked Secretary Herrick.
Political agitation inimical to the safety of the United States.
Smiling, Mr. Lee said, and arrested by a communist official in Cuba. It is a Zen paradox, which no doubt fails to delight Miss Hiyashi. Meanwhile, Bogart Crofts reflected. Empathy boxes were being collected in huge quantities. Soon their destruction would begin. Within 48 hours, most of the empathy boxes in the United States would no longer exist, including the one here in his office. It still rested on his desk, untouched. It was he who originally had asked that it be brought in. And in all this time, he had kept his hands off it and never yielded. Now he walked over to it. What would happen, he asked Mr. Lee, if I took hold of these two handles? There's no television set here. I have no idea what Wilbur Mercer is doing right now. In fact, for all I know, now he's finally dead. Mr. Lee said, If you grip the handle, sir,
You will enter a... I hesitate to use the word, but it seems to apply. A mystical communion with Mr. Mercer, wherever he is. You will share his suffering, as you know, but that is not all. You will also participate in his... Mr. Lee reflected. Worldview is not the correct term. Ideology? No. Secretary Herrick suggested.
What about Trenton State?
Perhaps that is it, Mr. Lee said, frowning. No, that is not it either. No word will do, and that is the entire point. It cannot be described. It must be experienced.
I'll try,
Crofts decided. No, Mr. Lee said. Not if you are following my advice. I would warn you away from it. I saw Miss Hiyashi do it, and I saw the change in her. Would you have tried paracoding when it was popular with ruthless cosmopolite masses? He sounded angry.
I have tried paracoding, Croft said. It did absolutely nothing for me.
What do you want done, Bogue?
Secretary Herrick asked him. Shrugging, Bogart Croft said, I mean, I could see no reason for anyone liking it, wanting to become addicted to it. And at last, he took hold of the two handles of the empathy box. Walking slowly in the rain, Ray Meriton said to himself, they got my empathy box, and if I go back to the apartment, they'll get me. His telepathic talent had saved him. As he entered the building, he had picked up the thoughts of the gang of city police. It was now past midnight. The trouble is, I'm too well known, he realized, from my damn TV show. No matter where I go, I'll be recognized. At least anywhere on Earth. Where is Wilbur Mercer? He asked himself. In this solar system or somewhere beyond it? Under a different sun entirely? Maybe we'll never know. Or at least, I'll never know. But did it matter? Wilbur Mercer was somewhere. That was all that was important. And there was always a way to reach him. The empathy box was always there, or at least had been until the police raids. And Meriton had a feeling that the distribution company which had supplied the empathy boxes, and which led a shadowy existence anyhow, would find a way around the police, if he was right about them. Ahead in the rainy darkness, he saw the red lights of a bar. He turned and entered it. To the bartender, he said, look, do you have an empathy box? I'll pay you $100 for the use of it. The bartender, a big, burly man with hairy arms, said, Nah, I don't have nothing like that. Go on. The people at the bar watched, and one of them said, those are illegal now. Hey, it's Ray Meriton, another said. The jazz man. Another man said lazily, play some gray-green jazz for us, jazz man. He sipped at his mug of beer. Meriton started out of the bar. Wait, the bartender said. Hold on, buddy. Go to this address. He wrote on a match folder and then held it out to Meriton. How much do I owe you? Meriton said. $5 ought to do it. Meriton paid and left the bar, the match folder in his pocket. It's probably the address of the local police station, he said to himself. But I'll give it a try anyhow. If only I could get to an empathy box one more time. The address which the bartender had given him was an old decaying wooden building in downtown Los Angeles. He rapped on the door and stood waiting. The door opened. A middle-aged heavy woman in bathrobe and furry slippers peeped out at him. I'm not the police, he said. I'm a Mercerite. Can I use your empathy box? The door gradually opened. The woman scrutinized him and evidently believed him, although she said nothing. Sorry to bother you so late, he apologized.
What happened to you, mister?
The woman said.
You look bad.
It's Wilbur Mercer, Ray said. He's hurt.
Turn it on,
the woman said, leading him with a shuffling into a dark, cold parlor where a parrot slept in a huge, bent brass wire cage. There, on an old-fashioned radio cabinet, he saw the empathy box. He felt relief creep over him at the sight of it.
Don't be shy, the woman said.
Thanks, he said, and took hold of the handles. A voice said in his ear, We'll use the girl. She'll lead us to Meriton. I was right to hire her in the first place. Ray Meriton did not recognize the voice. It was not that of Wilbur Mercer. But even so, bewildered, he held tightly onto the handles, listening. He remained frozen there, hands extended, clutching. The non-T force has appealed to the most credulous segment of our community. But this segment, I firmly believe, is being manipulated by a cynical minority of opportunists at the top, such as Meriton. They're crashing in on this Wilbur Mercer craze for their own pocketbooks. The voice, self-assured, droned on. Ray Meriton felt fear as he heard it, for this was someone on the other side, he realized. Somehow, he had gotten into empathic contact with him, and not with Wilbur Mercer. Or had Mercer done this deliberately, arranged this? He listened on and now heard, Have to get the Hiyashi girl out of New York and back here, where we can quiz her further. The voice added, As I told Herrick. Herrick, the Secretary of State. This was someone in the State Department thinking, Meriton realized. Thinking about Joan. Perhaps this was the official at State who had hired her. Then she wasn't in Cuba.
Holy shit.
She was in New York. What had gone wrong? The whole implication was that State had merely made use of Joan to get at him. He released the handles, and the voice faded from his presence. Did you find him? The middle-aged woman asked. Yes, Meriton said, disconcerted, trying to orient himself in the unfamiliar room.
How is he? Is he well?
I don't know right now, Meriton answered truthfully. He thought, I must go to New York and try to help Joan. She's in this because of me. I have no choice, even if they catch me because of it. How can I desert her? Bogart Croft said, I didn't get Mercer. He walked away from the empathy box, then turned to glare at it balefully. I got Meriton, but I don't know where he is. At the moment I took hold of the handles of this box, Meriton took hold somewhere else. We were connected, and now he knows everything I know, and we know everything he knows, which isn't much. Dazed, he turned to Secretary Herrick. He doesn't know any more about Wilbur Mercer than we do. He was trying to reach him. He definitely is not Mercer. Cross was silent then.
There's more, Herrick said, turning to Mr. Lee. What else did he get from Meriton, Mr. Lee?
Meriton is coming to New York to try to find John Hiyashi, Mr. Lee said, obligingly reading Croft's mind. He got that from Mr. Meriton during the moment their minds were fused.
We'll prepare to receive Mr. Meriton, Secretary Herrick said, with a grimace.
Did I experience what you telepaths engage in all the time? Croft asked Mr. Lee.
Only when one of us comes close to another telepath, Mr. Lee said. It can be unpleasant. We avoid it, because if the two minds are thoroughly dissimilar and hence clash, it is psychologically harmful. I would assume you and Mr. Meriton clashed.
Croft said, Listen, how can we continue with this? I know now that Meriton is innocent. He doesn't know a damn thing about Mercer or the organization that distributes these boxes, except its name. There was momentary silence.
But he is one of the few celebrities who has joined the Mercerites, Secretary Herrick pointed out.
He handed a teletype dispatch to Crofts.
And he has done it openly, if you'll take the trouble to read this.
I know, he affirmed his loyalty to Mercer on this evening's TV program, Crofts said, trembling.
When you're dealing with a non-T force originating from another solar system entirely, Secretary Herrick said, you must move with care. We will still try to take Meriton, and definitely through Miss Hiyashi. We'll release her from jail and have her followed. When Meriton makes contact with her...
To Crofts, Mr. Lee said, Don't say what you intend, Mr. Crofts.
It will permanently damage your career.
Croft said,
Eric, this is wrong. Meriton is innocent and so is Joan Hiyashi. If you try to trap Meriton, I'll resign from state.
Fuck.
Write out your resignation and hand it to me, Secretary Eric said.
His face was dark. This is unfortunate, Mr. Lee said. I would guess that your contact with Mr. Meriton warped your judgment, Mr. Crofts. He has influenced you malignly. Shake it off, for the sake of your long career and country, not to mention your family. What we're doing is wrong, Crofts repeated. Secretary Herrick stared at him angrily.
No wonder those empathy boxes have done harm. Now I've seen it with my own eyes. I wouldn't turn back on any condition now.
He picked up the empathy box, which Crofts had used. Lifting it high, he dropped it to the floor. The box cracked open and then settled in a heap of irregular surfaces.
Don't consider that a childish act, he said. I want any contact between us and Meriton broken. It can only be harmful.
If we capture him, Croft said, he may continue to exert influence over us. He amended his statement, or rather, over me.
Be that as it may, I intend to continue, Secretary Eric said. And please present your resignation, Mr. Croft. I intend to act on that matter as well.
He looked grim and determined. Mr. Lee said, Secretary, I can read Mr. Croft's mind, and I see that he is stunned at this moment. He is the innocent victim of a situation, arranged perhaps by Wilbur Mercer, to spread confusion among us. And if you accept Mr. Croft's resignation, Mercer will have succeeded.
It doesn't matter whether he accepts it or not, Croft said, because in any case I'm resigning.
Sighing, Mr. Lee said, the empathy box made you suddenly into an involuntary telepath, and it was just too much. He patted Mr. Crofts on the shoulder. Telepathic power and empathy are two versions of the same thing. It should be called telepathic box. Amazing, those non-T individuals. They can build what we can only evolve.
Since you can read my mind, Crofts said to him, you know what I'm planning to do. I have no doubt you'll tell Secretary Herrick.
Grinning blandly, Mr. Lee said, the Secretary and I are cooperating in the interest of world peace. We both have our instructions. To Herrick, he said, this man is so upset that he now actually considers switching over, joining the Mercerites before all the boxes are destroyed. He liked being an involuntary telepath.
If you switch, Herrick said, you'll be arrested. I promise it.
Croft said nothing. He has not changed his mind, Mr. Lee said urbanely, nodding to both men, apparently amused by the situation. But underneath, Mr. Lee was thinking, a brilliant bold type of stroke by the thing that calls itself Wilbur Mercer, this hooking up of Crofts with Meriton Direct. It undoubtedly foresaw that Crofts would receive the strong emanations from the movement's core. The next step is that Crofts will again consult an empathy box, if he can find one. And this time Mercer itself will address him personally. Address its new disciple. They have gained a man, Mr. Lee realized. They are ahead. But ultimately we will win. Because ultimately we will manage to destroy all the empathy boxes. And without them, Wilbur Mercer can do nothing. This is the only way he has, or it has, of reaching and controlling people. As it has done here with unfortunate Mr. Crofts. Without the empathy boxes, the movement is helpless. At the UWA desk at Rocky Field in New York City, Joan Hiyashi said to the uniformed clerk, I want to buy a one-way ticket to Los Angeles on the next flight. Jet or rocket, it doesn't matter. I just want to get there.
First class or tourist, the clerk said.
Oh, hell, Joan said wearily. Just sell me a ticket. Any kind of ticket.
She opened her purse. As she started to pay for the ticket, a hand stopped hers. She turned, and there stood Ray Meriton, his face twisting with relief.
What a place to try to pick up your thoughts, he said. Come on, let's go where it's quiet. You have 10 minutes before your flight.
They hurried together through the building until they came to a deserted ramp. There they stopped, and Joan said,
"Listen, Ray, I know it's a trap for you. That's why they let me out. But where else can I go, except to you?"
Ray said, "Don't worry about it. They were bound to pick me up sooner or later. I'm sure they know I left California and came here." He glanced around.
Well,
no FBI agents near us yet. At least I don't pick up anything suggesting it.
He lit a cigarette. "I don't have any reason to go back to L.A., Jones said. "Now that you're here, I might as well cancel my flight."
"You know they're picking up and destroying all the empathy boxes they can," Ray said.
"No," she said. "I didn't know. I was just released half an hour ago. That's dreadful. They really mean business."
Ray laughed. "Let's say they're really frightened." He put his arm around her and kissed her. "I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll try to sneak out of this place, go to the Lower East Side, rent a little cold water walk-up. We'll hide out and find an empathy box they missed." But he thought, it's unlikely. They probably have them all by now. There weren't that many to start with.
"Anything you say,"
Joan said drably. "Do you love me?" he asked her. "I can read your mind. You do." And then he said quietly, "I can also read the mind of a Mr. Lewis Scanlon, an FBI man who's now at the UWA desk. What name did you give?"
"Mrs. George McIsaacs," Joan said, "I think."
She examined her ticket and envelope.
"Yes, that's right."
"But Scanlon is asking if a Japanese woman has been at the desk in the last 15 minutes, Ray said. "And the clerk remembers you, so..." He took hold of Joan's arm. "We better get started." They hurried down the deserted ramp, passed through an electric eye-operated door, and came out in a baggage lobby. Everyone there was far too busy to pay any attention as Ray Meriton and Joan threaded their way to the street door, and a moment later stepped out onto the chill gray sidewalk where cabs had parked in a long double row. Joan started to hail a cab.
"Wait," Ray said, pulling her back. "I'm getting a jumble of thoughts. One of the cab drivers is an FBI man, but I can't tell which." He stood uncertainly, not knowing what to do.
"We can't get away, can we?"
Joan said.
"It's going to be hard."
To himself, he thought, "More like impossible, you're right." He experienced the girl's confused, frightened thoughts, her anxiety about him, that she had made it possible for them to locate and capture him, her fierce desire not to return to jail, her pervasive bitterness at having been betrayed by Mr. Lee, the Chinese communist big shot who had met her in Cuba.
"What a life,"
Joan said, standing close to him. And still, he did not know which cab to take. One precious second after another escaped as he stood there. "Listen," he said to Joan, "maybe we should separate."
"No," she said, clinging to him. "I can't stand to do it alone anymore. Please."
A bewhiskered peddler walked up to them with a tray suspended by a cord which ran about his neck.
"Hiya, folks," he mumbled.
"Not now,"
Joan said to him.
"Free sample of breakfast cereal," the peddler said. "No cost. Just take a box, miss. You, mister, take one."
He extended the tray of small, gaily colored cartons toward Ray. Strange, Ray thought. I'm not picking up anything from this man's mind. He stared at the peddler and saw, or thought he saw, a peculiar insubstantiality to the man, a diffused quality. Ray took one of the samples of breakfast cereal.
"Merry Meal, it's called," the peddler said. "A new product they're introducing to the public. There's a coupon inside. Entitles you to..."
"Okay," Ray said, sticking the box in his pocket. He took hold of Joan and led her along the line of cabs. He chose one at random and opened the rear door. "Get in," he said urgently to her.
"I took a sample of Merry Meal, too," she said with a wan smile as he seated himself beside her. The cab started up, left the line, and pulled past the entrance of the airfield terminal. "Ray, There was something strange about that salesman. It was as if he wasn't actually there. As if he was nothing more than a picture.
As the cab drove down the auto ramp away from the terminal, another cab left the line and followed after them. Twisting, Ray saw riding in the back of it two well-fed men in dark business suits. FBI men, he said to himself. Jones said, "Didn't that serial salesman remind you of anyone?"
"Who?"
"A little of Wilbur Mercer. But I haven't seen him enough to..." Ray grabbed a cereal box from her hand, tore the cardboard top from it. Poking up from the dry cereal, he saw the corner of the coupon the peddler had spoken about. He lifted out the coupon, held it up, and studied it. The coupon said in large, clear printing, "How to assemble an empathy box from ordinary household objects." "It was them," he said to Joan. He put the coupon carefully away in his pocket. Then he changed his mind. Folding it up, he tucked it in the cuff of his trousers, where the FBI possibly wouldn't find it. Beside them, the other cab came closer, and now he picked up the thoughts of the two men. They were FBI agents. He had been right. He settled back against the seat. There was nothing to do but wait. Jones said, "Could I have the other coupon?" "Sorry." He got out the other cereal package. She opened it, found the coupon inside, and after a pause, folded it and hid it in the hem of her skirt. "I wonder how many there are of those so-called peddlers," Ray said musingly. "I'd be interested to know how many free samples of Merry Meal they're going to manage to give away before they're caught." The first ordinary household object needed was a common radio set. He had noticed that. The second, the filament from a 5-year light bulb. And next, he'd have to look again. But now was not the time. The other cab had drawn abreast with theirs. Later. And if the authorities found the coupon in the cuff of his trousers, they, he knew, would somehow manage to bring him another. He put his arm around Joan. "I think we'll be all right." The other cab now was nosing theirs to the curb, and the two FBI men were waving in a menacing, official manner to the driver to stop.
"Shall I stop?"
the driver said tensely to Ray. "Sure," he said, and taking a deep breath, prepared himself.
That's the end of that story.
War with the...
Nope. Not gonna go with War with the Fnools. Not that it's a bad story. Yeah, okay. We can remember for you Wholesale. Oh, it's an hour. Okay, whatever.
"We can remember it for you Wholesale." He awoke and wanted Mars. The valleys, he thought. What would it be like to trudge among them? Great and greater yet, the dream grew as conscious. The dream and the yearning. He could almost feel the enveloping presence of the other world, which only government agents and high officials had seen. A clerk like himself? Not likely. "Are you getting up or not?" his wife Kirsten asked drowsily, with her usual hint of fierce crossness. "If you are, push the hot coffee button on the darn stove." "Okay," Douglas Quayle said, and made his way barefoot from the bedroom of their conap to the kitchen. There, having dutifully pressed the hot coffee button, he seated himself at the kitchen table, brought out a yellow small tin of fine Dean Swift snuff. He inhaled briskly, and the bone ash mixture stung his nose, burned the roof of his mouth. But still he inhaled. It woke him up and allowed his dreams, his nocturnal desires and random wishes, to condense into a semblance of rationality. "I will go," he said to himself. "Before I die, I'll see Mars." It was, of course, impossible, and he knew this even as he dreamed. But the daylight, the mundane noise of his wife now brushing her hair before the bedroom mirror, everything conspired to remind him of what he was. "A miserable little salaried employee," he said to himself with bitterness. Kirsten reminded him of this at least once a day, and he did not blame her. It was a wife's job to bring her husband down to earth. Down to earth, he thought, and laughed. The figure of speech in this was literally apt.
What are you sniggering about?
His wife asked as she swept into the kitchen, her long, busy pink robe wagging after her.
A dream, I'll bet. You're always full of them.
Yes, he said, and gazed out the kitchen window at the hover cars and traffic runnels, and all the little energetic people hurrying to work. In a little while, he would be among them, as always.
I'll bet it had to do with some woman,
Kirsten said witheringly. No, he said, a god, the god of war. He has wonderful craters with every kind of plant life growing deep down in them.
God fucking damn it.
Listen. Kirsten crouched down beside him and spoke earnestly, the harsh quality momentarily gone from her voice.
The bottom of the ocean, our ocean, is much more, an infinity of times more beautiful. Mm. You know that. Everyone knows that. Rent an artificial gill outfit for both of us. Take a week off from work. And we can descend and live down there in one of those year-round aquatic resorts. And in addition... She broke off. You're not listening. You should be. Here is something a lot better than that compulsion. That obsession you have about Mars. And you don't even listen.
Her voice rose piercingly.
God in heaven, you're doomed, Doug. What's going to become of you?
I'm going to work, he said, rising to his feet, his breakfast forgotten. That's what's going to become of me.
She eyed him. You're getting worse, more fanatical every day. Where is it going to lead?
To Mars, he said, and opened the door to the closet to get down a fresh shirt to wear to work. Having descended from the taxi, Douglas Quayle slowly walked across three densely populated foot runnels and to the modern, attractively inviting doorway. There he halted, impeding mid-morning traffic, and with caution read the shifting color neon sign. He had, in the past, scrutinized this sign before, but never had he come so close. This was very different. What he did now was something else, something which sooner or later had to happen. Recal Incorporated. Was this the answer? After all, an illusion, no matter how convincing, remained nothing more than an illusion. At least objectively, but subjectively, quite the opposite entirely. And anyhow, he had an appointment within the next 5 minutes. Taking a deep breath of mildly smog-infested Chicago air, he walked through the dazzling polychromatic shimmer of the doorway and up to the receptionist's counter. A nicely articulated blonde at the counter, bare-bosomed and tidy, said pleasantly,
"Good morning, Mr. Quayle."
"Yes," he said. "I'm here to see about a recal course, as I guess you know."
"Not recal, but recall,"
the receptionist corrected him. She picked up the receiver of the vidphone by her smooth elbow and said into it,
"Mr. Douglas Quayle is here, Mr. McLean. May he come inside now, or is it too soon?"
"Yes, well, wham,
the phone mumbled.
"Yes, Mr. Quayle," she said. "You may go in. Mr. McLean is expecting you."
As he started off uncertainly, she called after him,
"Room D, Mr. Quayle, to your right."
After a frustrating but brief moment of being lost, he found the proper room. The door hung open, and inside, at a big, genuine walnut desk, sat a genial-looking man, middle-aged, wearing the latest Martian frog pelt gray suit. His attire alone would have told Quayle that he had come to the right person.
"Sit down, Douglas,"
Klain said, waving his plump hand toward a chair which faced the desk.
"So, you want to have gone to Mars? Very good."
Quayle seated himself, feeling tense. "I'm not so sure this is worth the fee," he said. "It costs a lot. As far as I can see, I really get nothing. It costs almost as much as going," he thought.
"You get tangible proof of your trip,"
McLean disagreed emphatically. All the proof you'll need. Here, I'll show you.
He dug within a drawer of his impressive desk.
Ticket stub?
Reaching into a manila folder, he produced a small square of embossed cardboard.
It proves you went and returned. Postcards.
He laid out four franked picture 3D full-color postcards in a neatly arranged row on the desk for Quail to see.
Film. Shots you took of local sites on Mars with a rented moving camera.
To Quail, he displayed those too.
Plus the names of people you met. 200 postgrads worth of souvenirs, which will arrive from Mars within the following month. And passport, certificates listing the shots you received, and more.
He glanced up keenly at Quail.
You'll know you went all right, he said. You won't remember us, won't remember me, or ever having been here. It'll be a real trip in your mind. We guarantee that. A full 2 weeks of recall. Every last piddling detail. Remember this. If at any time you doubt that you really took an extensive trip to Mars, you can return here and get a full refund, you see?
But I didn't go, Quail said. I won't have gone, no matter what proofs you provide me with. He took a deep, unsteady breath. And I never was a secret agent with Interplan. It seemed impossible to him that Recall Incorporated's extra-factual memory implant would do its job, despite what he had heard people say.
Mr. Quail, McLean said patiently, as you explained in your letter to us, you have no chance, no possibility in the slightest of ever actually getting to Mars. You can't afford it. And what is much more important, you could never qualify as an undercover agent for Interplan or anybody else. This is the only way you can achieve your, lifelong dream. Am I correct, sir? You can't be this. You can't actually do this. He chuckled. But you can have been, and have done. We see to that. And our fee is reasonable. No hidden charges.
He smiled encouragingly. Is an extra-factual memory that convincing? Quail asked.
More than the real thing, sir. Had you really gone to Mars as an Interplan agent, you would by now have forgotten a great deal. Our analysis of true MEM systems, authentic recollections of major events in a person's life, shows that a variety of details are very quickly lost to the person. Forever. Part of the package we offer you is such deep implantation of recall that nothing is forgotten. The packet which is fed to you while you're comatose is the creation of trained experts, men who have spent years on Mars. In every case, we verify details down to the last iota. And you've picked a rather easy extra-factual system. Had you picked Pluto, or wanted to be Emperor of the Interplanet Alliance, we'd have much more difficulty, and the charges would be considerably greater.
Reaching into his coat for his wallet, Quail said, Okay, it's been my lifelong ambition, and so I see I'll never really do it. So I guess I'll have to settle for this.
Don't think of it that way, McLean said severely. You're not accepting second best. The actual memory with all its vagueness, omissions, and ellipses, not to say distortions, that's second best.
He accepted the money and pressed a button on his desk.
All right, Mr. Quail,
he said as the door of his office opened and two burly men swiftly entered.
You're on your way to Mars as a secret agent.
He rose, came over to shake Quail's nervous, moist hand.
Or rather, you have been on your way. This afternoon at 4:30, you will, arrive back here on Terra. A cab will leave you off at your conap, and as I say, you will never remember seeing me or coming here. You won't, in fact, even remember having heard of our existence.
His mouth dry with nervousness, Quail followed the two technicians from the office. What happened next depended on them. Will I actually believe I've been on Mars? He wondered. That I managed to fulfill my lifetime ambition? He had a strange, lingering intuition that something would go wrong. But just what? He did not know. He would have to wait and find out.
The intercom on McLean's desk, which connected him with the work area of the firm, buzzed, and a voice said, "Mr. Quayle is under sedation now, sir. Do you want to supervise this one, or shall we go ahead?"
"It's routine," McLean observed. "You may go ahead, Lo. I don't think you'll run into any trouble."
Programming an artificial memory of a trip to another planet, with or without the added fillip of being a secret agent, showed up on the firm's work schedule. A secret agent showed up on the firm's work schedule with monotonous regularity.
"In 1 month," he calculated wryly, "we must do 20 of these. Ersatz interplanetary travels become our bread and butter."
"Whatever you say, Mr. McLean." Lowe's voice came, and thereupon the intercom shut off. Going to the vault section in the chamber behind his office, McLean searched about for a 3-packet, trip to Mars, and a 62-packet, secret interplan spy. Finding the 2 packets, he returned with them to his desk, seated himself comfortably, poured out the contents, merchandise which would be planted in Quayle's conapt, while the lab technicians busied themselves installing false memory.
"A 1 postgrad sneaky Pete sidearm,"
McLean reflected.
"That's the largest item. It sets us back financially the most."
Then a pellet-sized transmitter which could be swallowed if the agent were caught. Codebook that astonishingly resembled the real thing. The firm's models were highly accurate, based, whenever possible, on actual U.S. military issue. Odd bits which made no intrinsic sense, but which would be woven into the warp and woof of Quayle's imaginary trip, would coincide with his memory. Half an ancient silver 50-cent piece. Several quotations from John Donne's sermons, written incorrectly, each on a separate piece of transparent tissue-thin paper. Several match folders from bars on Mars. A stainless steel spoon engraved, "Property of Dome Mars, National Kibbutzim." A wire-tapping coil, which... The intercom buzzed. "Mr. McLean, I'm sorry to bother you, but something rather ominous has come up. Maybe it would be better if you were in here after all. Quayle is already under sedation. He reacted well to the narcodrine. He's completely unconscious and receptive, but..."
"I'll be in."
Sensing trouble, McLean left his office. A moment later, he emerged in the work area. On a hygienic bed lay Douglas Quayle, breathing slowly and regularly, his eyes virtually shut. He seemed dimly, but only dimly, aware of the 2 technicians, and now McLean himself.
"There's no space to insert false memory patterns?"
McLean felt irritation.
"Merely drop out 2 work weeks. He's employed as a clerk at the West Coast Emigration Bureau, which is a government agency, so he undoubtedly has or had 2 weeks vacation within the last year. That ought to do it."
Petty details annoyed him, and always would. "Our problem," Lowe said sharply, "is something quite different." He bent over the bed, said to Quayle, "Tell Mr. McLean what you told us." To McLean, he said, "Listen closely." The gray-green eyes of the man laying supine in the bed focused on McLean's face. The eyes, he observed uneasily, had become hard. They had a polished, inorganic quality, like semi-precious tumbled stones. He was not sure that he liked what he saw. The brilliance was too cold. "What do you want now?" Quayle said harshly. "You've broken my cover. Get out of here before I take you all apart." He studied McLean. "Especially you," he continued. "You're in charge of this counter-operation." Lowe said, "How long were you on Mars?"
1 month,
Quayle said gratingly. "And your purpose there?" Lowe demanded. The meager lips twisted. Quayle eyed him and did not speak. At last, drawling the words out so that they dripped with hostility, he said, "Agent for Interplan, as I told you. Don't you record everything that's said? Play your vid on tape back for your boss and leave me alone." He shut his eyes then. The hard brilliance ceased. McLean felt, instantly, a rushing splurge of relief.
Lowe said quietly, "This is a tough man, Mr. McLean."
"He won't be," McLean said, "after we arrange for him to lose his memory chain again. He'll be as meek as before."
To Quail, he said,
"So this is why you wanted to go to Mars so terribly bad."
Without opening his eyes, Quail said, "I never wanted to go to Mars. I was assigned it. They handed it to me, and there I was, stuck. Oh yeah, I admit I was curious about it. Who wouldn't be?" Again, he opened his eyes and surveyed the three of them, McLean in particular. "Quite a truth drug you've got here. It brought up things I had absolutely no memory of." He pondered. "I wonder about Kirsten," he said half to himself. "Could she be in on it? An interplan contact keeping an eye on me? To be certain I didn't regain my memory? No wonder she's been so derisive about my wanting to go there." Faintly, he smiled. The smile, one of understanding, disappeared almost at once. McLean said,
"Please believe me, Mr. Quail. We stumbled onto this entirely by accident. In the work we do..."
"I believe you," Quail said. He seemed tired now. The drug was continuing to pull him under, deeper and deeper. "Where did I say I'd been?" he murmured. "Mars? Hard to remember. I know I'd like to see it. So would everybody else. But me..." His voice trailed off. "Just a clerk. Nothing clerk." Straightening up, Lowe said to his superior, "He wants a false memory implanted that corresponds to a trip he actually took. And a false reason, which is the real reason. He's telling the truth. He's a long way down in the narcodrine. The trip is very vivid in his mind, at least under sedation. But apparently, he doesn't recall it otherwise. Someone, probably at a government military sciences lab, erased his conscious memories. All he knew was that going to Mars meant something special to him. So did being a secret agent. They couldn't erase that. It's not a memory, but a desire. Undoubtedly the same one that motivated him to volunteer for the assignment in the first place." The other technician, Keeler, said to McLean, "What do we do? Graft a false memory pattern over the real memory? There's no telling what the results would be. He might remember some of the genuine trip, and the confusion might bring on a psychotic interlude. He'd have to hold two opposite premises in his mind simultaneously, that he went to Mars and that he didn't. That he's a genuine agent for Interplan, and he's not. That it's spurious. I think we ought to revive him without any false memory implantation. Send him out of here. This is hot."
"Agreed," McLean said.
A thought came to him.
"Can you predict what he'll remember when he comes out of sedation?"
"Impossible to tell," Lowe said. "He probably will have some dim, diffuse memory of his actual trip now. And he'd probably be in grave doubt as to its validity. He'd probably decide our programming slipped a gear to him, and he'd remember coming here. That wouldn't be erased. Unless you want it erased."
"The less we mess with this man," McLean said, "the better I like it. This is nothing for us to fool around with. We've been foolish enough to, or unlucky enough to, uncover a genuine Interplan spy who has a cover so perfect that up to now, even he didn't know what he was, or rather is."
The sooner they wash their hands of the man calling himself Douglas Quail, the better. "Are you going to plant packets 3 and 62 in his conapt?" Lowe said.
"No," McLean said. "And we're going to return half his fee."
"Half? Why half?" McLean said lamely.
"It seems to be a good compromise."
As the cab carried him back to his conapt at the residential end of Chicago, Douglas Quail said to himself, "It's sure good to be back on Terra." Already the month-long period on Mars had begun to waver in his memory. He had only an image of profound gaping craters, an ever-present ancient erosion of hills, of vitality, of motion itself. A world of dust where little happened, where a good part of the day was spent checking and rechecking one's portable oxygen source, and then the life forms, the unassuming and modest gray-brown cacti and more worms.
Fuck.
He had brought back several more abundant examples of Martian fauna. He had smuggled them through customs. After all, they posed no menace. They couldn't survive in Earth's heavy atmosphere. Reaching into his coat pocket, he rummaged for the container of Martian mawworms and found an envelope instead. Lifting it out, he discovered, to his perplexity, that it contained 570 postgrads in cred bills of low denomination. Where'd I get this? He asked himself. Didn't I spend every cred I had on my trip? With the money came a slip of paper marked, "One half fee returned by McLean." And then the date. Today's date. "Recall," he said aloud. "Recall what, sir?"
Jesus.
"Or madam?"
That was fast.
The robot driver of the cab inquired respectfully. "Do you have a phone book?" Quayle demanded. "Certainly, sir or madam." A slot opened. From it slid a microtape phone book for Cook County. "It's spelled oddly," Quayle said as he leafed through the pages of the yellow section. He felt fear then, abiding fear.
Wow.
"Here it is," he said. "Take me there, to Recall Incorporated."
Nice.
"I've changed my mind. I don't want to go home." "Yes, sir or madam, as the case may be," the driver said. A moment later, the cab was zipping back in the opposite direction. "May I make use of your phone?" he asked. "Be my guest," the robot driver said, and presented a shiny new Emperor 3D color phone to him. He dialed his own connect, and after a pause, found himself confronted by a miniature but chillingly realistic image of Kirsten on the small screen. "I've been to Mars," he said to her. "You're drunk." Her lips writhed scornfully. "Or worse." "It's God's truth." "When?" she demanded. "I don't know." He felt confused. "A simulated trip, I think. By means of one of those artificial or extrafactual or whatever it is memory places. It didn't take." Kirsten said witheringly, "You are drunk," and broke the connection at her end. He hung up then, feeling his face flush. "Always the same tone," he said hotly to himself. "Always the retort, as if she knows everything and I know nothing. What a marriage, Kirst," he thought dismally. A moment later, the cab stopped at the curb before a modern, very attractive pink building, over which a shifting polychromatic neon sign read, "Recall Incorporated."
Ooh.
The receptionist, chic and bare from the waist up, started in surprise, then gained masterful control of herself. "Oh, hello, Mr. Quayle," she said nervously. How are you? Did you forget something?" "The rest of my fee back," he said. More composed now, the receptionist said, "Fee? I think you are mistaken, Mr. Quayle. You were here discussing the feasibility of an extra-factual trip for you, but..." She shrugged her smooth, pale shoulders. "As I understand it, no trip was taken." Quayle said, "I remember everything, miss. My letter to Recall Incorporated, which started this whole business off. I remember my arrival here, my visit with Mr. McLean. Then the two lab technicians taking me in tow and administering a drug to put me out." No wonder the firm had returned half his fee. The false memory of his trip to Mars hadn't taken. At least not entirely. Not as he had been assured. "Mr. Quayle," the girl said, "although you are a minor clerk, you are a good-looking man. And it spoils your features to become angry. If it would make you feel any better, I might... let you take me out." He felt furious then. "I remember you," he said savagely. "For instance, the fact that your breasts are sprayed blue. That's stuck in my mind. And I remember Mr. Quayle's promise that if I remembered my visit to Recall Incorporated, I'd receive my money back in full. Where is Mr. McLean?" After a delay, probably as long as they could manage, he found himself once more seated facing the imposing walnut desk, exactly as he had been an hour or so earlier in the day. "Some technique you have," Quayle said sardonically. His disappointment and resentment was enormous by now. My so-called memory of a trip to Mars as an undercover agent for Interplan is hazy and vague and shot full of contradictions, and I clearly remember my dealings here with you people. I'd take this to the Better Business Bureau. He was burning angry at this point. His sense of being cheated had overwhelmed him, had destroyed his customary aversion to participating in a public squabble. Looking morose, as well as cautious, McLean said,
"We capitulate, Quayle. We'll refund the balance of your fee. I fully concede the fact that we did absolutely nothing for you."
His tone was resigned. Quayle said accusingly, "You didn't even provide me with the various artifacts that you claimed would prove to me I had been on Mars. Well, that song and dance you went into, it hasn't materialized into a damn thing. Not even a ticket stub, nor postcards, nor passport, nor proof of immunization shots, nor..."
"Listen, Quayle,"
McLean said.
"Suppose I told you..."
He broke off.
"Let it go."
He pressed a button on his intercom.
"Shirley, will you disperse 570 more creds in the form of a cashier's check made out to Douglas Quayle? Thank you."
He released the button, then glared at Quayle. Presently, the check appeared. The receptionist placed it before McLean and once more vanished out of sight, leaving the two men alone, still facing each other across the surface of the massive walnut desk.
"Let me give you a word of advice," McLean said as he signed the check and passed it over. "Don't discuss your recent trip to Mars with anyone."
"I didn't even look."
"What trip?"
"Well, that's the thing,"
doggedly McLean said.
"The trip you partially remember. Act as if you don't remember. Pretend it never took place.
I can't
place.
Buy it anyways.
Don't ask me why. Just take my advice. It'll be better for all of us."
He'd begun to perspire freely.
"Now, Mr. Quayle, I have other business, other clients to see."
He rose, showed Quayle to the door. Quayle said as he opened the door, "A firm that turns out such bad work shouldn't have any clients at all." He shut the door behind him. On the way home in the cab, Quayle pondered the wording of his letter of complaint to the Better Business Bureau, Terra Division. As soon as he could get to his typewriter, he'd get started. It was clearly his duty to warn other people away from Recall Incorporated. When he got back to his CONAPT, he seated himself before his Hermes rocket portable, opened the drawers, and rummaged for carbon paper, and noticed a small, familiar box. A box which he had carefully filled on Mars with Martian fauna and later smuggled through customs. Opening the box, he saw, to his disbelief, 6 dead mawworms and several varieties of the unicellular life on which the Martian worms fed. The protozoa were dried up, dusty, but he recognized them. It had taken him an entire day picking among the vast dark alien boulders to find them. A wonderful, illuminated journey of discovery. "But I didn't go to Mars," he realized. Yet, on the other hand, Kirsten appeared at the doorway to the room, an armload of pale brown groceries gripped. "Why are you home in the middle of the day?" Her voice, in an eternity of sameness, was accusing. "Did I go to Mars?" he asked her. "You would know." "No, of course you didn't go to Mars. You would know that, I would think. Aren't you always bleeding about going?" He said, "By God, I think I went." After a pause, he added, "And simultaneously, I think I didn't go." "Make up your mind." "How can I?" he gestured. "I have both memory tracks grafted inside my head. One is real, and one isn't. But I can't tell which is which. Why can't I rely on you? They haven't tinkered with you." She could do this much for him, at least, even if she never did anything else. Kirsten said in a level, controlled voice, "Doug, if you don't pull yourself together, we're through. I'm going to leave you." "I'm in trouble." His voice came out husky and coarse and shaking. "Probably I'm heading into a psychotic episode. I hope not. But maybe that's it. It would explain everything anyhow." Setting down the bag of groceries, Kirsten stalked to the closet.
I was not kidding, she said to him quietly.
She brought out a coat, got it on, walked back to the door of the CNIB.
I'll phone you one of these days, soon, she said tonelessly. This is goodbye, Doug. I hope you pull out of this eventually. I really pray you do. For your sake. Wait, he said desperately. Just tell me, and make it absolute. I did go, or I didn't. Tell me which one.
But they may have altered your memory track also, he realized. The door closed. His wife had left. Finally. A voice behind him said, Well, that's that. Now put up your hands, quail. And also, please turn around and face this way. He turned instinctively, without raising his hands. The man who faced him wore the plum uniform of the Interplan Police Agency, and his gun appeared to be UN issue. And for some odd reason, he seemed familiar to Quail. Familiar in a blurred, distorted fashion, which he could not pin down. So, jerkily, he raised his hands.
You remember, the policeman said, your trip to Mars? We know all your actions today and all your thoughts. In particular, your very important thoughts on the trip home from Recall Incorporated. He explained, we have a teletransmitter wired within your skull. It keeps us constantly informed. A telepathic transmitter. Use of a living plasma that had been discovered on Luna. He shuddered with self-aversion. The thing lived inside him, within his own brain, feeding, listening, feeding. But the Interplan police used them. That had come out even in the homeopapes. So this was probably true, dismal as it was.
Why me? Quail said huskily. What had he done or thought? And what did this have to do with Recall Incorporated?
Fundamentally, the Interplan cop said, this has nothing to do with Recall. It's between you and us. He tapped his right ear. I'm still picking up your mentational processes by way of your cephalic transmitter. In the man's ear, Quail saw a small white plastic plug. So I have to warn you, anything you think may be held against you. He smiled. Not that it matters now. You've already thought and spoken yourself into oblivion. What's annoying is the fact that under Narcadrine and Recall Incorporated, you told them, their technicians and the owner, Mr. McLean, about your trip, where you went, for whom, some of what you did. They're very frightened. They wish they had never laid eyes on you. He added reflectively, they're right. Quail said, I never made any trip. It's a false memory chain improperly planted in me by McLean's technicians. But then he thought of the box in his desk drawer containing the Martian life forms and the trouble and hardship he had had gathering them. The memory seemed real. And the box of life forms, that certainly was real. Unless McLean had planted it. Perhaps this was one of the proofs which McLean had talked glibly about. Memory of my trip to Mars, he thought, doesn't convince me, but unfortunately has convinced the Interplan Police Agency. They think I really went to Mars, and they think I at least partially realize it. We not only know you went to Mars, the Interplan cop agreed, in answer to his thoughts, but we know that you now remember enough to be difficult for us. And there's no use expunging your conscious memory of all this, because if we do, you'll simply show up at Recall Incorporated again and start over. And we can't do anything about McLean and his operation, because we have no jurisdiction over anyone except our own people. Anyhow, McLean hasn't committed any crime. He eyed Quail. Nor technically have you. You didn't go to Recall Incorporated with the idea of regaining your memory. You went, as we realize, for the usual reason people go there. A love by plain, dull people for adventure. He added, unfortunately, you're not plain, not dull, and you've already had too much excitement. The last thing in the universe you needed was a course from Recall Incorporated.
nothing could have been more lethal for you or for us. And, for that matter, for McLean. Quayle said, "Why is it difficult for you if I remember my trip, my alleged trip, and what I did there?" "Because," the Interplan Harness Bull said, "what you did is not in accord with our great white all-protecting father public image. You did for us what we never do. As you'll presently remember, thanks to Narcadrine. That box of dead worms and algae has been sitting in your desk drawer for 6 months, ever since you got back. And at no time have you shown the slightest curiosity about it. We didn't even know you had it until you remembered it on your way home from recall. Then we came here on the double to look for it." He added unnecessarily, "Without any luck, there wasn't enough time." A second Interplan cop joined the first one. The two briefly conferred. Meanwhile, Quayle thought rapidly. He did remember more now. The cop had been right about Narcadrine. They, Interplan, probably used it themselves. Probably. He knew darn well they had. He had seen them putting a prisoner on it. Where would that be? Somewhere on Terra? More likely on Luna, he decided, viewing the image rising from his highly defective, but rapidly less so, memory. And he remembered something else. Their reason for sending him to Mars. The job he had done. No wonder they had expunged his memory. "Oh, God," the first of the two Interplan cops said, breaking off his conversation with his companion. Obviously, he had picked up Quayle's thoughts. "Well, this is a far worse problem now. As bad as it can get." He walked toward Quayle, again covering him with his gun. "We've got to kill you," he said, "right away."
No fucking hell.
Nervously, his fellow officer said, "Why right away? Can't we simply cart him off to Interplan New York and let them?" "He knows why it has to be right away," the first cop said. He too looked nervous now, but Quayle realized that it was for an entirely different reason. His memory had been brought back almost entirely now, and he fully understood the officer's tension. "On Mars," Quayle said hoarsely, "I killed a man. After getting past 15 bodyguards. Some armed with sneaky peep guns the way you are." He had been trained by Interplan over a 5-year period to be an assassin, a professional killer. He knew ways to take out armed adversaries, such as these two officers. And the one with the ear receiver knew it too. If he moved swiftly enough, the gun fired. But he had already moved to one side, and at the same time, he chopped down the gun-carrying officer. In an instant, he had possession of the gun and was covering the other confused officer. "Picked my thoughts up," Quayle said, panting for breath. "He knew what I was going to do, but I did it anyhow." Half sitting up, the injured officer grated, "He won't use that gun on you, Sam. I picked that up, too. He knows he's finished. And he knows we know it, too. Come on, Quayle." Laboriously, grunting with pain, he got shakily to his feet. He held out his hand. "The gun," he said to Quayle. "You can't use it. And if you turn it over to me, I'll guarantee not to kill you. You'll be given a hearing, and someone higher up in Interplan will decide, not me. Maybe they can erase your memory once more. I don't know. But you know the thing I was going to kill you for. I couldn't keep you from remembering it. So my reason for wanting to kill you is, in a sense, past." Quayle, clutching the gun, bolted from the connat, sprinted for the elevator. "If you follow me," he thought, "I'll kill you. So don't." He jabbed at the elevator button, and a moment later, the doors slid back. The police hadn't followed him. Obviously, they had picked up his terse, tense thoughts and had decided not to take the chance. With him inside, the elevator descended. He had gotten away for a time. But what next? Where could he go? The elevator reached the ground floor. A moment later, Quayle had joined the mob of peds hurrying along the rungs. His head ached and he felt sick. But at least he had evaded death. They had come very close to shooting him on the spot, back in his own connat. "They
probably will again, he decided, when they find me. And with this transmitter inside me, that won't take too long. Ironically, he had gotten exactly what he had asked Recall Incorporated for. Adventure, peril, interplan police at work, a secret and dangerous trip to Mars, in which his life was at stake, everything he had wanted as a false memory. The advantages of it being a memory and nothing more could now be appreciated. On a park bench, alone, he sat dully watching a flock of perts, a semi-bird imported from Mars's two moons, capable of soaring flight, even against Earth's huge gravity. Maybe I can find my way back to Mars, he pondered. But then what? It would be worse on Mars. The political organization whose leader he had assassinated would spot him the moment he stepped from the ship. He would have Interplan and them after him there. Can you hear me thinking? He wondered. Easy avenue to paranoia. Sitting here alone, he felt them tuning in on him, monitoring, recording, discussing. He shivered, rose to his feet, walked aimlessly, his hands deep in his pockets. No matter where I go, he realized, you'll always be with me, as long as I have this device inside my head. I'll make a deal with you, he thought to himself, and to them. Can you imprint a false memory template on me again, as you did before, that I lived an average, routine life, never went to Mars, never saw an Interplan uniform up close, and never handled a gun? A voice inside his brain answered, as has been carefully explained to you, that would not be enough. Astonished, he halted.
Oh, come on.
We formally communicated with you in this manner,
whatever it is.
The voice continued. When you were operating in the field on Mars, it's been months since we've done it. We assumed, in fact, that we'd never have to do so again. Where are you? Walking, Quayle said, to my death. By your officer's guns, he added as an afterthought. How can you be sure it wouldn't be enough? He demanded. Don't the recall techniques work? As we said, if you're given a set of standard average memories, you get restless. You'd inevitably seek out Recall or one of its competitors again. We can't go through this a second time. Suppose, Quayle said, once my authentic memories have been canceled, something more vital than standard memories are implanted. Something which would act to satisfy my craving, he said. That's been proved. That's probably why you initially hired me. But you ought to be able to come up with something else, something equal. I was the richest man on Terra, but I finally gave all my money to educational foundations. Or was I a famous deep space explorer? Anything of that sort. Wouldn't one of those do? Silence.
Come on.
Try it, he said desperately. Get some of your top-notch military psychiatrists. Explore my mind. Find out what my most expansive daydream is. He tried to think. Women, he said. Thousands of them, like Don Juan had. An interplanetary playboy, a mistress in every city on Earth, Luna, and Mars. Only I gave that up out of exhaustion. Please, he begged. Try it. You'd voluntarily surrender, then? The voice inside his head asked. If we agreed to arrange such a solution, if it's possible. After an interval of hesitation, he said, yes. Take the risk, he said to himself, that you don't simply kill me. You make the first move, the voice said presently. Turn yourself over to us, and we'll investigate that line of possibility. If we can't do it, however, if your authentic memories begin to crop up again, as they've done at this time, then... There was silence, and then the voice finished. We'll have to destroy you. As you must understand. Well, Quayle, you still want to try? Yes, he said, because the alternative was death now, and for certain. At least this way he had a chance, slim as it was. You present yourself at our main barracks in New York, the voice of the Interplan cop resumed, at 585th Avenue, floor 12.
once you've surrendered yourself, we'll have our psychiatrists begin on you. We'll have personality profile tests made. We'll attempt to determine your absolute ultimate fantasy wish. Then we'll bring you back to Recall Incorporated here. Get them in on it, fulfilling that wish in vicarious surrogate retrospection. And good luck. We do owe you something. You acted as a capable instrument for us. The voice lacked malice. If anything, they, the organization, felt sympathy toward him. Thanks, Quayle said. Began searching for a robot cab.
Nice book.
Mr. Quayle, the stern-faced, elderly interplan psychiatrist said, you possess a most interesting wish fulfillment dream fantasy. Nothing such as you can't set you too much. The senior-ranking interplan officer present said briskly,
better not be too much upset to hear about it. Not if he expects not to get shot.
Unlike the fantasy of wanting to be an interplan undercover agent, the psychiatrist continued, which, being, relatively speaking, a product of maturity, had a certain plausibility to it, this production is a grotesque dream of your childhood. It is no wonder you fail to recall it. Your fantasy is this. You are 9 years old, walking alone down a rustic lane. An unfamiliar variety of space vessel from another star system lands directly in front of you. No one on Earth but you, Mr. Quayle, sees it. The creatures within are very small and helpless, somewhat on the order of field mice, although they are attempting to invade Earth. Tens of thousands of other ships will soon be on their way when this advance party gives the go-ahead signal. And I suppose I stop them, Quayle said, experiencing a mixture of amusement and disgust. Single-handed, I wipe them out, probably by stepping on them with my foot. No, the psychiatrist said patiently. You halt the invasion, but not by destroying them. Instead, you show them kindness and mercy, even though by telepathy, their mode of communication, you know why they have come. They have never seen such humane traits exhibited by any sentient organism. And to show their appreciation, they make a covenant with you. Quayle said, they won't invade Earth as long as I'm alive. Exactly. To the interplan officer, the psychiatrist said, you can see it does fit his personality, despite his feigned scorn. So by merely existing, Quayle said, feeling a growing pleasure, by simply being alive, I keep Earth safe from alien rule. I'm in effect, then, the most important person on Terra, without lifting a finger. Yes, indeed, sir, the psychiatrist said, and this is bedrock in your psyche. This is a lifelong childhood fantasy, which, without depth and drug therapy, you never would have recalled. But it has always existed in you. It went underneath, but never ceased. To McLean, who sat intently listening, the senior police official said,
can you implant an extra-factual memory pattern that extreme in it? We can hand it every possible type of wish fantasy there is, McLean said. Frankly, I've heard a lot worse than this. Certainly we can handle it. 24 hours from now, he won't just wish he'd saved Earth. He'll devoutly believe it really happened.
The senior police official said,
you can start the job, then. In preparation, we've already once again erased the memory in him of his trip to Mars.
Quayle said, what trip to Mars? No one answered him, so reluctantly he shelved the question. And anyhow, a police vehicle had now put in its appearance. He, McLean, and the senior police officer crowded into it, and presently they were on their way to Chicago and Recall Incorporated.
You had better make no errors this time, the police officer said to heavy-set, nervous-looking McLean. I can't see what could go wrong, McLean mumbled, perspiring. This has nothing to do with Mars or Interplan. Single-handedly stopping an invasion of Earth from another star system.
He shook his head at that.
Wow, what a kid dreams up. And
by pious virtue, too, not by force. It's sort of quaint.
He dabbed at his forehead with a large linen pocket handkerchief. Nobody said anything.
In fact, Plain said, it's touching. But arrogant, the police official said starkly. Inasmuch as when he dies, the invasion will resume. No wonder he doesn't recall it. It's the most grandiose fantasy I ever ran across.
The eye quailed with disapproval.
And to think we put this man on our payroll.
When they reached Recall Incorporated, the receptionist, Shirley, met them breathlessly in the outer office.
Welcome back, Mr. Quayle, she fluttered. Her melon-shaped breasts, today painted an incandescent orange, bobbing with agitation. I'm sorry everything worked out so badly before. I'm sure this time it'll go better.
Still repeatedly dabbing at his shiny forehead with his neatly folded Irish linen handkerchief, McLean said,
it better.
Moving with rapidity, he rounded up Lowe and Keeler, escorted them and Douglas Quayle to the work area, and then, with Shirley and the senior police officer, returned to his familiar office to wait.
Do we have a packet made up for this, Mr. McLean?
Shirley asked, bumping against him in her agitation, then coloring modestly.
I think we do.
He tried to recall, then gave up and consulted the formal chart.
A combination, he decided aloud, of packets 81, 20, and 6.
From the vault section of the chamber behind his desk, he fished out the appropriate packets, carried them to his desk for inspection.
From 81,
he explained,
a magic healing rod given him, the client in question, this time Mr. Quayle, by the race of beings from another system, a token of their gratitude. Does it work?
The police officer asked curiously.
It did once,
McLean explained.
But he, you see, used it up years ago, healing right and left. Now it's only a memento. But he remembers it working spectacularly.
Ooh.
He chuckled, then opened packet 20.
Document from the UN Secretary General thanking him for saving Earth. This isn't precisely appropriate because part of Quayle's fantasy is that no one knows of the invasion except himself. But for the sake of verisimilitude, we'll throw it in.
He inspected packet 6, then. What came from this? He couldn't recall. Frowning, he dug into the plastic bag as Shirley and the Interplan police officer watched intently.
Writing, Shirley said, in a funny language.
This tells who they were, McLean said, and where they came from. Including a detailed star map logging their flight here, and the system of origin. Of course, it's in their script, so he can't read it. But he remembers them reading it to him in his own tongue.
He placed the three artifacts in the center of the desk.
These should be taken to Quayle's Conapt, he said to the police officer, so that when he gets home, he'll find them. And it'll confirm his fantasy. S.O.P. Standard Operating Procedure.
He chuckled apprehensively, wondering how matters were going with Lowe and Keeler. The intercom buzzed.
Mr. McLean, I'm sorry to bother you.
It was Lowe's voice. He froze as he recognized it, froze and became mute.
But something's come up. Maybe it would be better if you came in here and supervised. Like before, Quayle reacted well to the narcotrine. He's unconscious, relaxed, and receptive, but...
McLean sprinted for the work area. On a hygienic bed, Douglas Quayle lay breathing slowly and regularly, eyes half shut, dimly conscious of those around him.
We started interrogating him, Lowe said, white-faced. To find out exactly when to place the fantasy memory of him single-handedly having saved Earth. And strangely enough,
they told me not to tell.
Douglas Quayle mumbled in a dull, drug-saturated voice.
That was the agreement. I wasn't even supposed to remember. But how could I forget an event like that?
I guess it would be hard.
McLean reflected.
But you did. Until now.
They even gave me a scroll, Quayle mumbled.
Levine said,
"Well, I offer the suggestion that you better not kill him. If you do, they'll return."
They also gave me a magic, invisible destroying rod, Quail mumbled, eyes totally shut now. That's how I killed that man on Mars you sent me to take out. It's in my drawer along with the box of Martian mawworms and dried up plant life.
Wordlessly, the Interplan officer turned and stalked from the work area.
I might as well put those packets of proof artifacts away,
McLean said to himself resignedly. He walked, step by step, back to his office,
including the citation from the UN Secretary General. After all,
the real one probably would not be long in coming.
Okay.
Not by its...
Yep. So... I wish there was a really short story I could put on. Because the electric ant's a little bit friggin' long. Guess not. Oh well, I think that should be about it, honestly. We don't need to listen to anything else. Anyways, yeah, I think I'm... I'll finish this boss off. He'll probably kill me. So. Oh wow, I survived. Oh well, how long have we been fucking at this shit? I don't even know. Fucking, well, let's find out. I really just don't fucking know. Probably not that long. Oh well, whatever. It doesn't matter. I think I'm done. No, maybe not. That's fuck it. Let's just go. See how long I can do this shit for. No more desecrating though. Again, I actually want to beat this game today, not fuck around. Shit. I dropped health. I heard it. Fast. Holy shit, my 145. My fucking god. Usually not that fast, is it? Kinda just fucking running through without a care in the world, it seems. As good as what I got. Oh, whatever. Yeah, I'm done. I am done. I'll see you later, folks.